I'd like to ask all of our speakers to come to the front, and we can maybe put some chairs here. And Drew is going to run our panel. Why don't people move up, because we're...
Students coming together with the community to build low-income housing, and we often talk about that being a big part of our mission within architecture. So what I want to do is open up to the panel your thoughts of architecture education, and maybe with now what you know of what the relationship we're trying to build with Mercy Corps, what could be maybe a mission statement or something that could be a driving factor moving forward.
Am I getting educated? I think what you're doing is great. I'm really, really inspired by your collaboration. I think our old, you asked about, so what was the question about architectural education? What do we think of?
I guess you actually were.
Well, I can answer. You don't need to go back there. I can answer. I think it's the old model is corrupt, totally corrupt. It's time to throw it out. And we are educating far too many architects in this country. And we are especially educating far too many for the old model. We need architects, but not doing what they
traditional.
Yeah. And I think architecture is one of the best foundational educations one can get at the undergraduate level. And at the graduate level, it's something else again. But I think it's a great education. But as long as we keep training people to go into traditional practice, we're doing no good for our society. And all we're doing is training people to go to China and build new towns and hotels and whatever. So it's time to challenge the model, and there aren't enough discussions about it. And you know, 2 years ago, my husband was hired by the state of New York to go start yet another architecture program. At least this one was to be affordable. Now that's going in the right direction, but we don't need more. We need different.
Mm-hmm. And how do we create that environment to make architecture students more entrepreneurial motivated, I guess?
I think we have to, this discussion is happening. Our whole educational model, never mind architecture, is based on the 19th century, not even the 20th century. You know, it's really based on an industrializing world, and we're past that. We're in a whole new era. We don't know where things are going. All we know is that we can't sustain this old model financially. We're not training people for the jobs that are needed, and we've got to start breaking down the academy, and we've got to stop all of this degree inflation that's going on is truly terrifying. So, you know, I think it's really up to you guys to be screaming loudly, and for those of us in the academy to not be afraid. You know, I sit on so many faculty committees where people are saying, well, until you get tenure, you can't possibly speak up. And I'm like, hell you can. I mean, think of how many people there are in this country who don't have tenure, and think of how few full-time academic positions there are anymore. They're all adjunct. So who says you can't speak up? You know, and that, I think, you know, working in countries that are truly fearful of sticking their heads up above the sand, I mean, our country is becoming like that, and that's scary. We need to take a stand, and we need to start taking command. Students need to take command of their own education, and faculty need to take command of decision making, and they have to stop running scared all the time. And the administration has to stop being the deciders of where the universities are going. Revolution.
Yeah, it starts today. Yeah. So
well, I think to me it depends on why, you know, it starts with the decision of why you go to architecture school. And there are a lot of different reasons why people go to architecture school. You know, I went to architecture school after serving as an office manager for a firm in San Francisco that did affordable housing. I was curious about architecture. I didn't do my undergraduate in architecture. I didn't know what I wanted to do in undergrad. Halfway through, I had to pick something. I thought maybe architecture was too late. So found out you could do a master's program without having your undergraduate. And I took some time to figure out why architecture, and for me, it was the social aspect, the social benefit that architects could provide. So from that standpoint, it depends on how you want to wind your way through your architectural education and what you think you are going to provide society in a way when you leave. If you think you're going to be a star designer, then you're following the traditional path of architecture, and you're probably going to be pretty unhappy when you first get out of school, that you're not going to necessarily be able to apply that trade that you spent 4 years teaching yourself. But if you're going in for maybe a broader sense of what architecture can be, then I think that you can tailor your education. And I'm very inspired to see how you can tailor your work outside of school and not necessarily go right into traditional practice. So I'm not discounting what you're saying at all, but I am saying that I think over time people, depending on why they go into the architecture field, can chart a path for themselves that isn't the traditional means of education.
That's a really good point. And with our interaction with John and the Mercy Corps clients, we've had a lot of great conversations. We just did a charrette with four business owners, and then looking for space, kind of their long-term or short-term, long-term plans, and the students put together a presentation for them and showing what they could do with that space. So I thought that was interesting because it not only gave a value to that business owner, but the students then created this relationship. And the hope is that maybe that would continue to grow as they enter, or that once they finish up their studies, that they could take that value to a firm and even continue that relationship with that business, kind of this whole incubator thing. Yep.
Just wanted to comment on your question, well, to kind of propose my opinion. I think that architecture schools need to stop pushing the traditional process on students while they're in school. Like, it's wonderful that you have this technical experience, but if that is embedded more in the curriculum, then it doesn't necessarily have to be forced upon you to go work in an architecture firm where you're a CAD monkey, and then you're getting out and you have expectations because you have this experience, and then you get a job right after, and you're still a CAD monkey for, you know, 2-3 years. Really being open to alternative architectural experiences while they're enrolled in school, and also considering that to put it in the curriculum to some extent, that we're teaching social entrepreneurship through architecture and design in the schools. And I think that what Mercy Corp is doing with OU is a great start to that.
But what is limiting that in many programs are the accreditation requirements.
Yeah.
And it becomes this great noose around the neck.
Yeah.
And the fact that you have to go through it so often, and they keep trying to extend things, but it's still, you're constantly thinking about your next reaccreditation visit.
It's always front and center.
Yes. I think that this, my experience working with Mercy Corps, it's really been about learning to see the problems. Just putting yourself in an environment where you're surrounded by people who have needs. And you think about, with your design training, like if you just put a designer in a room with somebody who is experiencing, you know, some sort of trouble, it doesn't matter what that trouble is, you're gonna come up with some crazy solutions, right? And training yourself to be in that room and to be a listener and to look around and think about how design can help. And then look around for how, like what else do you need to help you implement whatever that solution is? Because it's not always a building, right? It's other things too. And how do you form relationships with people outside of your discipline? How do you communicate the value of design just when you're out in the world? Because I think design thinking, you know, that's the big buzzword right now, but there's a lot of value to that way of thinking. And that if you can, even if you are in traditional practice, you know, if you can zoom out a little bit and question the brief that's given to you, that you're creating your own problems because you know that design can help solve certain things in this world, and you know how to ask for help for other things. But yeah, it's been a great way to practice that.
But it's also, it goes back to just thinking about how one practices. As somebody who worked in traditional practice in a large international firm for too long, I do think that if we taught people strategy in school, that you could actually do work that falls under that umbrella of traditional practice, but also achieve the other objectives you personally have, if you know how to make your project smarter and have them achieve multiple ends at once, so that there's widespread benefit, but you have to know how to communicate that benefit to those who have the money and the power. But I actually think we can get many more things done than we believe. And that's why so many of our students are now going on to business school, is basically to get strategy training.
John, what do you make of all this?
Well, I realized when I came up here that I'm the only male, so I'm kind of polluting the stream. Well, I think that I didn't push the architecture school. I think there's enough going on with us that there's a great future on the path that you're, Andy, and the whole school, James out there, I think was our first connecting point when we were filled with that building out at 67 Foster that left us, unfortunately. But there's a lot of threads of latitude from our perspective, you know. There's wide latitude, but kind of high expectations. That's probably the way it is working in this building with Mercy Corps, working in 45 of the toughest places in the world. And we're just working in Oregon and Washington is what I'm responsible for. So it's sort of easy in comparison, but it isn't. It's a different set of circumstances. So one challenge, I just thinking as I was sitting here, is a big part of our work is working with people coming out of prison. Now, how do you put a design element, an architectural perspective onto that sort of reintegration and productivity? That's another smart group of students project next year, maybe, not our.
Yeah.
So, you know, this has just opened up a whole range of what's possible and how different partnerships, you know, born by our proximity, really, but sure glad we moved down here with PDC support and that you were in the building next to us, but I wish that kind of proximity wasn't required for collaboration. I hope we would have been collaborating, but for our next door neighbor status, you know, and push each other.
I actually have a comment. I have to say there's a tremendous amount of product designers that we see that start their own businesses that are architecture graduates. And they either never went into practice in architecture or they came out of it because they were frustrated with it. So they're jewelry designers, they're furniture designers, they're clothing designers, very, very common. So I think there's a lot of other applications for it, and I find that people, you know, take the design skill and apply it to starting their own small companies. It's extremely common.
Mm-hmm. And it is, just being talking to these entrepreneurs, it is very inspiring. I mean, you know, every moment they're thinking, you know, time is money, and we want to talk about, you know, sometimes we need to hone our conversation and say, you know, we really need to just get to the brass tacks here. But John, that point about the, you know, what your mission is, and I think that's really important for us to consider and really start to include in ours, because it's design can often be just what we think is appropriate, or, you know, a beautiful museum or a new library, and, you know, bringing down the, you know, design for people coming out of prison. I mean, that's a totally different way of thinking about how can design influence other people. So. Any questions from the audience? James?
So I got a question. Kind of overall theme is trying to make economic development work for kind of somewhat grassroots for the micro entrepreneur. But I'm looking at kind of the bigger issues around this is like how, I mean, this thing's far out to think about, but thinking about how social restructuring might happen based on economic development for a select few within a community versus overall community resilience. And just wondering if there's any kind of post-occupancy, post-project evaluation, and what type of indicators there might be attached to that.
That's a heavy one.
In one sentence.
Can you sum that up?
Actually, I'm gonna say you're James.
Should I come say agent?
Is that one email?
Because I just said to Naomi, because post-project evaluation and impact assessment is a really sticky wicket. And I was saying to Naomi after her comments about all the groups that are fighting for the same few dollars, that's a huge issue we deal with in our work in South Asia. Huge issue. There are such inefficiencies built into the system because people are not pooling their efforts and their people and their resources. And they are fighting over a few dollars. And it also leads to, there's no incentive for accurate. There's no incentive for truthful assessment, because if you truly assess what's gone right and what's gone wrong, you're not going to be eligible for the next grant. And so it's a huge, huge problem.
Is is that something that that maybe the government organizations or some other outside force that has the long-term vision in mind?
No, governments are notorious for measuring tangible goods. They measure tangible outcomes. They don't measure the processes you put in motion. You know, when you asked, when John, you said that about people coming out of prison, I was thinking, well, you know, designing a reintegration process is design. You know, that again, design is not, you know, we don't talk about, this group for sure doesn't talk about design in big deal. You know, we talk about design in very broad terms. But it's, you know, it's very difficult. One, it's very difficult to assess this kind of thing because it is very slippery and very,
and yet that's exactly the reason why you need to do it, even if it's fully imperfect. Just to bring it back to architecture, if you think about building a LEED building like this one, you know, LEED platinum, and then you put the plaque up and boom, all right, we did it. But the continuity of how the building performs and the people in it perform relative to a number of other outcomes is actually something you can track, but people kind of stop their tracking once the building's built.
Well, that's the other problem is that projects have time. And so again, there isn't really a structure for that long-term assessment unless
hopefully it isn't government and funders, but some other mechanism that actually does have continuity. We had just a very quick segue. Brian Crocker is a board member of Mercy Corps, former long-term diplomat in the roughest place from Syria, Iraq, Afghanistan, and he was talking about diplomatic challenges because of the change in politics administration. Mm-hmm. And the continuity of the relationships with the countries. And he could talk more freely because he is a diplomat now. And he's been very candid talking about the challenge in Syria primarily, but its links and how the continuity, and Iraq, and how the continuity of consistent engagement in politics would steer us on paths that collided continuously without just that persistence and continuity of communication.
Yeah, I'd agree with that. I mean, I've experienced, from working in the public sector for quite some time now, just how we try to track things and depends on the administration or what's the buzzword at the time. You know, like we may have tracked these demographics, but now we want to track different demographics. We're going to track these. And even some of the inputs and outputs that we track don't actually even tell you anything. And then later we realize this is a priority. So I agree that it would be great, like maybe this is even like a private sector opportunity, is like to have some sort of a long-term tracking that's like not from the government, not from an NGO, because that's a huge problem. And we constantly deal with it from all levels. But you know, I agree too, and I think, sometimes governments or organizations will come out and say, wait, why are you complaining? We track these things and here's all the great stuff that we've done, but they never actually listened to the people in the first place. I know my organization has experienced that time and time and time again, particularly in North Northeast Portland, and we're like, hey, look all the great stuff we're doing, and then it's like, wait, but you never listened to us and asked us what we wanted. It happens all the time, but then they just use this data to try to, hold it over. I mean, and we own that, right? We know we have a really sticky history around that. But, yeah.
And it's unfortunate because that's the information that you have to turn over to them to keep that good relationship, to apply for that future grant, support that project that you want to do in a year or two. So it's kind of
not perfect.
I just like to bring it back to the original question, if I may. We had this discussion on the faculty a few days ago at our faculty meeting about a proposal by the National Registration Board to allow licensure on graduation, right? Which to a lot of people is very, very terrifying for a lot of the reasons that people are putting forward. And it is scary, right? But then I look at people like Drew and Annie who are just graduating, have incredibly strong social intentions in architecture, and their needs are not going to be solved by thinking about these things in the long term, right? Their needs are immediate, right? Because if those needs are not solved, then they're kind of lost. You see, in a sense. And so I'm wondering, in very practical terms, what can we do right now in terms of our collaboration with Mercy Corps, in terms of what we've started, to sort of satisfy their needs, which have to do with really dealing with architecture from a strong social point of view and making a living. You know, this is the immediate problem. And it's fine to talk about revolution, and I agree with you, Lily, completely, but at the same time, there's sort of a tomorrow we need to deal with this.
No, but I do think one of the things I'm really encouraged by is, you know, when I spend a lot of time around architecture schools in other countries, and I've always been impressed by how their students come out and there are no jobs, so they go and they form these very loose collaboratives and do the work they want to do, and they use their skills very broadly. So if there's no architecture that can pay the bills, there might be web design that can pay the bills. And so they're very, very agile, and they're very creative in terms of how they put together the money, making part of their life, and doing the work they need to do. And I've been waiting for our students to catch up, and I think they're beginning to catch up now. I think, you know, the implosion of the early 90s, over 75% of all designers on the East Coast were unemployed. All designers. And then this recession actually didn't hit the East Coast quite as badly, didn't hit the design community as badly, but it did send the big firms into another kind of eruption. And so it's happened twice fairly recently, where big firms have blown apart and become a whole bunch of little, very agile firms. I think it's really, really healthy. I mean, talk about resilience. That's resilience. Resilience is where the parts of the system can realign, reconfigure. It's like the neurons in your brain, you know, that they can quickly reconnect, and the system as a whole moves forward and has adapted to a changed set of circumstances. So I think, you know, personally, I was thinking about Carolina earlier, and I thought, you know, what she wants to do and her background in medicine could come together so well with some of my recent grads who are not going into offices, partly because there are no jobs, and partly because they'd die. Their brains would dry up and blow away. And so they are finding very interesting ways to work right now. And I'm thinking, okay, so it's working in Providence, between Providence and Boston. Well, what about between Providence and Eugene? You know, why not? Why not? We've got, with our interconnectedness through the internet now, we can be doing this in a very, very interesting way. And where people, you know, again, the component parts are going to reconfigure around particular opportunities. Right now, health in the city, big topic all over this country. And it doesn't mean that you're in health care, but the whole issue of health. And, you know, we're having a conference in November. There's another one at Brown in the spring. I mean, they're just showing up all the time. Well, why can't these loose confederations of architects go in and make these very powerful presentations about, you know, what could be done and what is being done or whatever. I just think there's no more waiting. There's absolutely no more waiting. We all have to act now. And I think that's exciting, you know? The world's going to hell in a handbasket. We've got to get going.
So to piggyback off that, because I was on the East Coast during the recession when there was this kind of implosion of the job market, and I got to be a part of this wave of volunteers in design, and that they wanted to do something, and they couldn't work, so they were gonna, and they have these strong social values, and so they just started doing stuff. They just started building stuff and talking to each other and working together, because, you know, they could. And I guess if you remove the burden of having to get paid, you can do all kinds of things. but talk about the system and these new ways to work. I mean, Architecture for Humanities local chapters, I think, are a great example of ways that people start to talk across the world and across the country about how they can adapt to what assets that they have in their city, and then trying to come up with ways to get paid on top of that. And so if we have to live this double life of during the day you work in an office and you become a competent professional, because you can't do that doing little tiny design build things without, you know, advice generally, it's way quicker to go into an office and work. And if you have the energy and you're young, you know, have your social work at night and then your professional work in the day, and then someday you can, you know, you can redesign the system around it.
Well, the other thing people used to, and this is an example, but people would try to do that, go into a firm with heavy school loans and then feel trapped and not feel able. You know, I went in for 2 years to learn how to run a business, and I stayed a whole lot longer. And it's, you know, it's a safety issue. You've got a paycheck. It's very hard to walk away from that. But now with firms laying people off left and right constantly, it's no longer this great social stigma to be laid off. It's part of life. And I see students go in and out of firms with the same firm with some regularity. And it's not about being afraid anymore. It's about, it's all more opportunistic in a good sense. And so people, if they did a good job, they'll be rehired when that firm needs them. But in the meantime, they go on and do the work that's more personally meaningful. And so again, if you're willing to be agile, you can put together a pretty interesting life. It's also why a lot of us teach. You know, one, we love to teach, but it also, you know, my teaching supports Design Lab.
I think that this kind of breakdown of firms, whatever you call it, is a very healthy, ultimately a very healthy phenomenon. But I also think there are firms and there are firms, right?
Yeah.
I mean, there are firms that I can't say categorically that the architectural profession is evil.
No.
And I don't think you're saying that either, but I think, you know, Lisa described how she's been able to be in a firm and sort of do what she wants to do. Right, and
but it is also working within a certain parameter.
And I think there are firms in
Eugene
that are doing the same thing. So it's kind of, I think there's a huge variety of kinds of situations
but
in
I
the
would
architectural
say,
profession.
I agree, but I would also say, I mean, there is a lot to be learned moving forward in this sort of new economy. I mean, that's part of what we're talking about here right now, is this new economy. And one of the things that I see is the potential for collaboration that you really gain by reaching out and not staying inwardly focused. And I can't actually give you a really strong example of how we're doing that yet. It's, I've only been a principal at our firm for a year and a half, and it's getting my sea legs. And it's this new influx of energy in the firm. And we've recently hired a bunch of new young people, and that is sort of bringing a lot of energy. We just haven't channeled it yet, but I'm seeing a change. I think the one upside of the recession is that it kind of broke a lot of the old paradigms, because people just had to, they had to do something else. They had to do something different. There was no other choice. And so I feel like, yes, there are firms that maybe do a balancing act to do what they want to do. And I feel like as a student coming out, you can do your best to try to find those firms. You can try to channel your education. I do firmly believe that unless you can change the architectural education so that you get, during school, a more real-time integration, maybe with working directly with clients or working with the community directly, there is a lot to still be learning to get out of school if you have not worked out in the profession, and in whatever way you're going to work in the profession, there is just something to be said for doing that. And it's in that real learning on the job. But you don't necessarily have to follow the rote path that, at least I think I was sort of thought that you had to follow when I first got out of school. That being said, I also, the very first thing I did is I drove all the way across the country and I took a very tiny paid and almost unpaid internship for Design Corps, which is sort of like a precursor to some of your core work. And I did that because I didn't want to get a real job right away. I came back to San Francisco and realized, oops, it's a little hard to get a real job, but luckily I focused my attention on affordable housing, which was my interest, and I made sure I got a job in a firm that had my interest. Now, I know it's a different economy, a different world right now, but I still do believe that you have the power to channel your education.
Roseva, the intern that we hired, you know, she went to work within the community that she cared about, and that ultimately led to her being able to get an architectural job.
By the way, Annie works 16-hour days. All right, we all symposium out.
I guess we are.
Howard was just running away.
I was really symposiumed out.
Yeah, are there any, oh, we got
thank you all. It's been really a fun day. I've enjoyed it very much. All the presentations. I thought one of the things that's really wonderful about this collaboration between Mercy Corps and micro entrepreneurs is exactly what I think Annie was getting at, is that the students, you've all been exposed to these people who are entrepreneurs, who are taking risks, making their own products, and you've had a lot of evidence how, you know, they can do things, and there's a lot of support out there for that, and I think that's a wonderful lesson to take with you and to have those connections. I also think this issue of the value of design for anyone, for both entrepreneurs for all those functional reasons, but I mean, I just like being in this building. Mercy Corps decided they would find a good architect to make good space to connect to the historic building and add to our city. I mean, it's really quite a wonderful thing, and I think that that lesson can percolate down in many ways, and that's something that goes back in the other way. And I just had a couple thoughts about that question about how to transform design education, and I think one thing that is out there that hasn't been talked about, it's always in the edges, is that my kids in high school, they had a community service requirement. You probably all did that to get through high school. I do not understand why in architecture school, we have some very nice things, this thing, design groups and other things, why we don't just assume that there will be a community service requirement that's integrated into the curriculum. I'm not quite sure everyone should. That Over the Rhine project, and people love that. I mean, it's really transformative. I know that the AIA, maybe you know more, was talking about having a required, instead of military service, design service.
Actually, I'm a
Do you know about
believer.
That?
I don't know about that, but I'm a strong believer
Absolutely.
In national service.
Absolutely. We should do this. I mean, yeah. We should invest in you guys so you can get out of school, you have basic income, and you see the country and you make a contribution. I mean, I don't know why.
Well, they used to do this for doctors.
They still do.
Yeah, I have my neighbors are, it's interesting, my neighbors are RAs, and they got, you know, incredible loans, and so they went to an underserved community, which was Crescent City, California, for 5 years and worked, and they got a serious reduction in their loans. So, and I do believe there are some programs, or was there the beginning of a program?
There's, what is it, Design for America out of Northwestern? But I do think there should be national service for everyone. But I think it should be very creatively designed.
Yes,
well, and there's a series of fellowships out there, but it's staggering how many people apply to these fellowships. There's just an overwhelming demand. The millennial generation, it just wants this kind of experience, and it's the capacity is just not there. So and also the legislation for loan reimbursement for. If you put in 10 years of service, you can get your loans forgiven, and that already exists for all of these other professions, but it does not exist for architecture.
I know that AIA and AIDS are working on the National Design Services Act, which then will start creating loan forgiveness when architecture grads go into your community service. So I think it was put to Congress, and it's in the process, so I mean, hopefully in the future people will get that, and we'll do it on our own. Yeah.
We'll pay them off ourselves. I also just, there's one other thought I wanted to add to the service aspect is that, and I don't know whether this is implied, is that there's a firm that we're working with, one of our startup challenge companies, and they're our only service firm. They're graduates of Parsons, sorry. And so what they're doing actually is that they have a design training
but then they have an entire training around community engagement. So there's this powerful thing about being a designer and being a translator, that you could actually be the one who's designing, but actually one of the powerful things you offer a lot of communities, and especially if you're from that community, is being that translator between the designers and the community. Because it's kind of interesting, I have an urban planning training, and a lot of the language and the way that you all talk is very different from how I... It's interesting when you're in different professions, how the language that people use and how it's different. And even, you know, urban planning is pretty similar. But so I think that that's a very powerful thing that you can bring to the table, and being a translator also speaks to that wider, you know, palette of skills. And I mean, I know this is really basic, relationship. It's just so critical. Like the architects that I've worked with, the way that they work with some clients that are small businesses that just have no clue, right? And the level of hand holding, high touch to the extreme, really requires a lot of. I mean, that's not for everybody, but there's just so many things about your personality and your style that are kind of 90% of what you do. And you might have this training in design, but how you work with someone, how you listen to them, is like the most critical thing.
We have to vacate. By 5, I think, since having dinner here. Would you grab your cups and recycle them, and then, and can we have those rollers, if you don't mind grabbing your chair and stacking it?
Yeah, talk about service.
We'll look like we weren't even here.
That's what we're
thank you again.
Thank you.